question or some thing which we want to share, Professor Bernardo unfortunately could not join us because of some unforeseen circumstances. So what he did, he sent us audio embedded PPT slides. So we will play those slides. So the voice is bit lower, so I suppose you just put it your microphone and hear it. And whatever questions you have, you can mail us or him directly. He will then respond. Okay, so we will just play out the PPTs. I'll just, in the meanwhile, I'll just give the brief introduction of Professor Dias. Dr. Bernardo Dias, he graduated at Chemical Engineering from Universal Federal Rio de Janeiro in 2005 and obtained his master's and doctoral degrees from the same institute. Now he is a professor at Biochemical Engineering Department in UFRGA, and since November 2018, he is a visiting researcher at IST from University de Lisboa in Portugal. He has experience in clean technologies and focuses on enzymatic processes, natural product valorization, and nootropic solvents such as ionic liquids and deep eutectic solvents. So we will start the PPT.
You can do some kind.
From School of Chemistry, Federal University of Rio de Janeiro. And today, my lecture is about Eutectic solvents and bioprocess. Well, first of all, we need to describe better about bioprocess. Bioprocess is a combination, the union of macrobiology, enzymology, and industrial process. What's this? Is the in resume, it's all the industrial process that use microorganisms or enzymes to obtain any kind of product. So, do I have to use any type of solvent in a bioprocess? In a bioprocess, well, I have to know something about how the bioprocess works. To understand industrial fermentation, we have two types of bioprocess in a general way. We have industrial fermentation and enzymatic reactions and industrial scale. So, in a general flowchart, we have three steps, three large, major steps. We have, first of all, the upstream operations. We have to prepare all the bio stuff before the fermentation begins. So you have to put the microorganisms, and you have to increase this, the concentration, the cell concentration of the microorganisms to in the sense of industrial scale. We have to prepare all the raw material using pretreatments if it's necessary, everything in the sterile conditions to go to the next step, the fermentation per se. where you use in many kinds of the fermentations use air. In the aerobic fermentation, anaerobic, no, you don't use air. But you produce your byproducts here, and then you have all the conditions, you have all the controls, pH control, temperature control. You have all the others components of the culture medium here as well, not only raw material. You have buffers, solutions, sulfate source, everything. And then you have the downstream operations, and you produce by fermentation, then you have to separate everything to obtain your product pure. So where solvent comes here, where they can fit in? Well, you can use solvent here in fermentation, or here in downstream operations. That is more common in downstream operations, that you have an option in the cell disruption, some kinds of products is intracellular, so you have to disrupt the cell to release these products to the medium. Some kinds of these options is to use solvents to disrupt or permeabilize the cell, or in the extraction or purification process, extraction from the medium, the products from the medium, or purification, recrystallization, kind of that. You can use many kinds of solvents here. Or in fermentation. In fermentation, you can use here in this type of presentation. You can use the solvent as in situ product recovery, such as extractive fermentation. So here you can use the solvent, but the solvent can have to be biocompatible, meaning the solvent I don't want the solvent to kill the microorganisms. The microorganisms have to produce everything in the presence of this solvent, and can be a stimulus to produce more, that the solvent remove the product is being generated here, remove in the same time, and then the microorganisms need to produce more. So it's not a new approach, but it's not new, but it's a good approach to stimulate the fermentation, stimulate a more production. So you can use a solvent here. Well, so we know now where our solvents can be used too. In enzymatic reactions, you have something very, very similar, we have the raw material, you can call substrate. You can have some kind of treatment as well before you enter the bioreactor, if the enzyme be inserted in here, and then you have downstream operations as we showed before. So you have some questions to answer before using the Eutectic solvents. The question is, how much toxic is the solvent for microorganisms? Is the solvent promoting cell death, inhibiting the cell growth, or maybe just permeabilizing the cell? Is there any interaction with microbial DNA or RNA? And with proteins, with microbial proteins or other proteins? How much toxic is the solvent for environment? Could we directly extract the metabolites from culture medium? Could enzymes maintain their activity and stability in the presence of solvents? So we have something to think. And then the presentation here is going to be aiming to respond some of these questions. So first of all, is the question about toxicity. Okay, just remember Eutectic solvents. I think everyone knows about Eutectic solvents in this end of the day. So yeah, you can mix it to solids, heat and make a liquid, or just greens and make a liquid. We have here a graphic about variation, the temperature and variation, the composition of the eutectics. And you have two components with higher temperatures of fusion. And then the mixtures have the lowest value. And because of this is eutectics, you have the passage of the solid state for liquid state in one direct way. And the great stimulus of all is easy to prepare. No need of purification. And it's not here, but it's very important. It's cheap. It's much more cheap than ionic liquids. Well, so first of all, is I want to present about toxicity. Try to answer these questions. So, are deep Eutectic solvents benign or toxic? Is the first work about this topic is published in 2013 by the high-end group. And then in this work, you'd be very happy. High-end group verified the influence of eutectics on bacteria inhibition using just a petri dish. They put the bacteria to grow 24 hours in a specific agar medium, and then put a cotton, a paper disc on the center and embedded with the eutectics and with the component, the pure component. So we have here on this table. First is the Eutectic choline chloride glycerol, then glycerol and just choline chloride. And the same thing for the next is here with the ethylene glycol, 3-ethylene glycol and urea. And four types of bacteria, 2 gram positive bacteria and 2 gram negative bacteria that have some difference in the cell wall composition. And the gram negative have more more layers in the cell wall. You have lipopolysaccharides, then a second plasmatic membrane, phospholipid membrane. Then you have some peptidoglycan. And the gram positive has a huge layer of peptidoglycan. So you have some difference in the cell wall, and so you expect some difference in response about inhibition of growth. And in this case, you don't have inhibition at all. Everything grows very well. So nice. Then the Highland groups did another work in the same year, using instead of choline chloride, use a phosphonium eutectic, this MTPB, but using the same hydrogen bond donors, glycerol with ethylene glycol and 3-ethylene glycol. Then some results can be seen here. Some inhibition were presented. And then, first of all, we can discuss that depending on hydrogen bonding acceptor, we have a different behavior. So you have here just a photo about these tests, this petri dish test. You see here an inhibition, you have a halo about the paper disc. So you see here that is not very precise data, because depending on the diffusion of this material, you have a difference in the halo diameter, but is a good qualitative data. Although this work used as a quantitative data. Whatever. Well, another approach instead of petri dishes, you can use also other kind of organisms instead of bacteria and fungi. You can use virus, fish cells, human cells, in this case cancer cells, plants, seed plants, or in vivo, animals, and marine organisms. Well, everything is turning to in vitro tests. Now, it's the in vivo, and many kinds of in vivo tests is not not encouraged anymore, né, to avoid. But we have to focus in microorganisms, in bacteria, fungi here. Although many kinds here is not used in the industrial scale. Here, Aspergillus nigris is in the wrong box. It's just a fungi. But we can use petri dish to screening the eutectics if has an answer about has inhibition or not, and then we can use a quantitative method as MICI, MIC, minimum inhibition concentration. There is meaning that is the concentration that eutectic solvents allow some growth of the microorganisms, just a little more quantity, a little more concentration of eutectics, and then the bacterial fungi is dead. So it's important information in the case that if you want to use the eutectic solvents with microorganisms to a biotransformation, or maybe the extractive fermentation. So important information to avoid, to avoid transpass this limit of concentration. You have to use above this limitation. But also can be a useful information about antimicrobial compounds. That's okay. You have other tests here to evaluate. So we have idea what tests we can make to evaluate toxicity, but we can imagine what is really important to influence to determine the toxicity. What are the major factors for toxicity profiles? First, type of cation. The type of cation can lead to a charge the localization that occurs during the formation of eutectic. So, for example, collinium, the collinium cation, enhance the toxicity of certain mixtures through the interaction of the side chains and head groups with cellular membrane groups. The accumulation of positively charged cations creates electrostatic attraction on the surface of cells' membranes, and this eventually damages the negatively charged bilayer, phospholipids. So, collinium can make everything that is right here. So it can induce some problems in the membranes, some pores. So you see here that depending on the combination of cation in anion, you have to think about the Hofmeister series for higher ions concentration, or higher ionic concentration. Meaning that you have two types, né, of ions, cosmotropic and chiotropic, that respectively the high and low degree of hydration around the ion. So mixing here two chiotropic anions and cations, or two cosmotropic anions and cations, can be a problem for membranes, and the strong affinity with the bilayer's cationic residues of the membranes can induce here, can lead into increasing a membrane porosity, releasing lactated dehydrogenase, that is a important enzyme from macroorganism metabolism. So you can verify the increase of the porosity analyzing this enzyme in the medium. Also can promote the synthesis of ROS, radical oxygen species, that is meaning there is a oxidative stress occurring and is can lead to apoptosis of the cell. And you can just go to disruption of cellular membranes. Everything can be occurring at the same time, or just one of these options. Other thing to think is the chemical nature of the HBG. So organic acids can be a problem. For example, oxalic acid. A work from the group of Professor Isabel Marrucho studied this case in changing the synthesis method for, instead of heating, using grinding, you can verify that can formation of derivatives, kind of esters or degradation products, and even increasing the acidity of the system. So low pH, probably the cell is not going to grow. Probably is high probability of death. So if you can use other types of HBG, such sugars, amines, and alcohols, can be better to the cell or to the microorganisms.
Okay, until now we talk about the toxicity. We know that microorganisms can be present with eutectic solvents, but they wanna be crazy and go very mutations. Something happens with the DNA, RNA. So some people, like the group of the Professor Nicholas Hood, start working with this in the 2010 with this work. And his group showed that native DNA structures can be preserved in the presence of choline chloride, urea, but is less stable than in the aqueous solutions. So it's the first trial. Yeah, we can preserve the DNA. It's good. And then, if other work we try to use another types of choline chloride eutectics using glycerol and ethylene glycol, and it's soluble. The DNA is soluble with some mass, with 2.5% WW or 5.5%. Searing 25 degrees Celsius. Maybe because the interactions between the choline cations and phosphate groups of DNA. And the important information here is that no degradation was found. They made electrophoresis and no degradation was found, even after 6 months of storage at room temperature. It's a big, huge information. Don't give the information about you can take this DNA, inserting some microorganisms and try to express some protein and see that if it works. But it's something, it's a big something. And we can be more comfortable to use eutectic solvents with microorganisms without going to any mutations. I think it's good to know. Until now, no work using biphasic systems, sativ fermentation, was published that I know. Nothing was published using this idea. So maybe we can try. It's not very easy. My group here in Brazil try something using ionic liquids. So it's more complicated than seems, because to maintain a biphasic system using ionic liquids in probably with eutectic solvents, you made every study using a standard condition with salts concentrations well defined, and in fermentation the culture medium is not well defined. Industrial culture medium is not well defined. So you have extract that have so many components. You have wastes of corn. So we have a big variation in the composition of the medium in that have a big influence in the formation of two phases. So it's a necessary work to do, but it's more slow than I want. But we don't have stratified fermentation, but we have biotransformation. You can use a whole cell, you can use the microorganisms in the presence of some quantity of the eutectic solvents, no, not everything, but something, and make a type of reaction. In this case, we call biotransformation, biotransformation. So you use the microorganisms as a catalyst. So you can have some examples here. Baker yeast, Acetobacter, Escherichia coli, Lysinibacillus fusiformis, and to make biotransformation. So you have some examples. It's only with colline-based eutectic solvents. But now we have so many types of eutectics that they have a big, vast world to explore. As of microorganisms, enzymes is very, very associated with biocatalysis and very used. So enzymes are highly specific proteins. They act efficiently on mild conditions, pH and temperature, pH ranging from 4 to 9, a temperature ranging from room temperature, 20 degrees Celsius, to until 70, 60 degrees Celsius. Have some exceptions, but that's the general, which are required to preserve the functionality and integrity of biological systems. So enzymes are essential inside us, but we have to think the industrial enzymes. So first work doing associating enzymes, industrial enzymes with eutectic solvents is from the Professor Kaslauskas from University of Minnesota, his group. You see here the comparison with many eutectic solvents based on colline chloride and based in the ammonium type, and comparison with the molecular solvents toluene in this reaction, esterification, transesterification, using ethyl valerate and butanol. And this lipases here is very known, commercially very known, from Candida Antarctica. I think here is porcine, pancreas, I think it's pancreas. And you here see that the efficiency of the conversion of this reaction at 60 degrees Celsius is very high, very comparable to the toluene. Using here colline chloride glycerol, colline chloride urea, this one here with ammonium type with glycerol. Everything is good with different types of lipases. Here the I here is the immobilized Calbi, free Calbi, probably free Calwa, have two types of this lipase of the same microorganisms. And here PCL don't have any. But you see that it's comparable. Also, this work is a mark. You have to use this in first time. Then show the conversion of another reaction, the aminolysis of ethyl valerate with 1-butylamine, with the immobilized type of Candida Antarctica lipase type B. So you see here that colline chloride urea and colline chloride glycerol has a better productivity. In 1 hour, it's achieved here higher than 90% of conversion. And toluene is just almost 80%. That the same result of the colline chloride urea, meaning that in this reaction, in these two reactions, you can change go away with toluene and use Eutectic. So it's good results. It's stimulating. Well, so you have to study some aspects and using Eutectic solvents for enzymatic biocatalysis. So first factor is the solvent concentration. You can go to 100% Eutectic. The enzyme don't want that. The enzyme is going to be inhibited. So you can see here in this graphic, high concentration of TES, low activity of enzyme, and maybe some high stability. What's the meaning? Meaning that the enzyme can maintain this low activity for a long time. This meaning that some quantity of water is necessary to maintain enzymatic activity. Besides, decrease the viscosity of Eutectic solvent. Yeah, the presence of water, you're going to be decreasing the viscosity. But each enzyme, each type of enzyme, needs some minimal quantity of water to maintain their 3D structure. Okay, so it's going to depend on the type of the enzyme. Here in this example, it is using alpha aminosyl beta glucosidase in the deglycosylation of pyridine, a type of phenolic compound. So you see here, choline, urea, after 40%, no activity, glycerol maintain to better after 80%, no activity, and ethylene glycol after 60%, no activity. We see this in my lab too. Here the presence, the effect of the water content. Here in the first graphic, you see the effect on subtilisine, it's a protease, immobilized protease, and tert-butanol, a molecular solvent. You see a small, low activity. And then using the same enzyme with acetate, choline, and glycerol. Small increase in the activity and high increase and in the selectivity. Then use these immobilized enzyme in choline chloride glycerol, and the activity increase a lot. Yeah. And meaning 10 times. And selectivity is good too. And then comparing to free enzyme, no immobilization, you have also a good activity. The advantage of using an immobilization method is to reuse the enzyme. And then this reaction is the transesterification of N-acetyl-L-phenylalanine ethyl ester and 1-propanol. So depending on the quantity of water and the type of the Eutectic solvents influence very much in the activity and the selectivity of this reaction. So just another, we can see the effect on pH.
have different enzyme activity of different pH is normal. You see an increase here using eutectic solvent. In this reaction, you see the reaction between Bucoderia sepacia lipase hydrolyzing paranitrophenyl palmitate under phosphate buffer, meaning EAC that we see before is N-diethyl ethanol ammonium chloride. Okay. You can see also the effects of temperature. Yeah, a very better increase here. The thermal stability of the enzyme is increased using these two eutectic solvents. So you go to optimum aspect with the methanol, maybe 35 and 45 degrees Celsius, to with choline chloride and ethylene glycol to 50 to 70. So a good increase, a good increase in the thermal stability. Another aspect here is the viscosity. High viscosity is a great affect the mass transfer. So if the diffusion of substrates or diffusion of products generating the in this reaction are affected, the reaction rate is decreased as well. So you have very difficult problems, majorly with the immobilizing enzymes. You can be a key hydrogen bond formation, high formation of hydrogen bonds, for example, high number of hydroxyl groups in their chain. Relate to high enzymatic stability and activity. And another point is the byproduct formation. You have to be careful using some kinds of eutectics that have the HBD group as alcohol or polyol, because you can be a side effect here that you sterification, you wanna be this HBG group too. Example here is choline chloride with glycerol using lipase in sterification reaction with organic acids, mainly fat acids, can promote the formation of monoglycerides. Here, just the compilation of this, all this data. Have here many uses of lipases, majorly noticing 435. Probably iCalbi here is this enzyme 435. It's a very known lipase, immobilizing lipase in the market. And here other enzymes besides lipase that have been used in reactions, probably aqueous solutions of the eutectic solvents, but in some cases the lipase is as well, but it's advance in this area to use eutectic solvents with enzymes. To end my presentation, I just going to present here a result of my group with Professor Isabel Marrucho.
using here the influence of betaine and choline based eutectic solvents on lipase activity. I just wanna to emphasize here the hyperactivation effect that can be present. Here you see the it's a relative activity percentage, meaning that 100% is the basis, the standard with no eutectic, and then we achieve 2000 relative activity use choline chloride urea with immobilized lipase, in this case thermomyces lanuginosus lipase, that a lipase very good to hydrolyze things. So in this case, hydrolyzing paranitrophenyl laurate in phosphate buffer, 37 degrees Celsius for 10 seconds. And there's a big difference when this enzyme is mobilized and free. And we go just until 20%. Besides that, the material of the support of immobilization just disintegrates. So, but it demonstrates here the hyperactivation effect. If you need more reference about this subject, you can see here someone I can send to you. And thank you for all your attention, and that my lab. Well,
okay.
Thank you for all your attention, and that my lab here in Brazil. Okay. Thank you.
So that was the end of our first day of the workshop. I hope you got to know various aspects of eutectic solvents and some other lectures like aspect to scientific writing. So we meet tomorrow at 10:30 for the first lecture, which is through this is not related to eutectic solvent, but it is related to one of the event which our those who are from outside, you must be knowing that our government is celebrating the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. So due to that, they want to have one lecture regarding about Gandhian thoughts. So the first lecture is devoted to such an exercise. So kindly join at around 10:30, where Professor Archana Burua of IIT Guwahati shall present and disseminate the Gandhian thoughts and its philosophy. Thank you all again for joining us. And if you have any questions regarding this lecture by Professor Ribeiro, you can mail him directly with the email IDs which you have given in the last slide. Else, we will put that email ID on our group within the Microsoft Teams. Thank you again. We will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.